Okay, you've just finished your lecture on nouns, and now we're going to finish up with our twofold lecture on nouns and pronouns by investigating pronouns. So we've just looked at nouns, and nouns, we looked at these heuristics or tips or tricks for identifying nouns, and we saw that they could take a couple different features. We worked on the basic definition of a noun, which is a person, place, or thing, and we need to know what a noun is because that's going to help us understand what pronouns are. Pronouns refer to participants or someone or something. So it's similar to what a noun can do. I have a little video here that if you want to go to the PowerPoint, you can push play and watch this simple video on pronouns. It's kind of cute. But pronouns, what's interesting about that, so when I with our heuristic, our tip or trick for identifying pronouns, is that pronouns can replace a noun. Okay, so whenever we have a noun, we can technically replace it with some type of pronoun. And so we're going to investigate all the layers of pronouns that exist out there, and there are eight different types of pronouns we're going to look at today, many of which you are familiar with, some of which you might not have known. Oh, that's what we call that part of speech. That's a pronoun. So we're going to look at that. Now, there are lots of types of pronouns, but we need to know them in order to avoid sentences like this. Pronouns help us in our speech. So Jessica and Ashley are friends, and Jessica and Ashley often hang out on the weekend. Susie does not like Jessica and Ashley, so Susie did not invite Jessica and Ashley to Susie's sleepover. Jessica and Ashley knew Susie had a sleepover without Jessica and Ashley, so Jessica and Ashley had a sleepover just for Jessica and Ashley. Okay, that's a very long-winded sentence. And here's what pronouns allow us to do with language. Jessica and Ashley are friends, and they often hang out on the weekend. Susie does not like them, so she did not invite them to her sleepover. They knew she had a sleepover without them, so they had a sleepover just for themselves. So pronouns are super helpful because they help us speak efficiently and quickly and coherently. And you'll notice the difference between the first passage and the second is that in the second, I've highlighted the pronouns, and you can see how often we use those to replace the nouns. And in this case, we've been replacing the proper nouns Jessica, Ashley, and Susie throughout the passage. So they're super important to learn because they help us become effective communicators. There are lots of types of pronouns that we're going to look at. And the first is we're going to look at how first person, second person, and third person pronouns work. And these pronouns are important because they're ways of describing points of view. So who is the one doing the speaking? Who are we referring to? Are we referring to first person, meaning me, second person, you, or third person, he? Okay? So we're going to investigate those type of perspective pronouns. We call these personal pronouns. They're the most common pronouns out there. They communicate person, gender, and number. And so these are subject, object, possessive, and reflexive pronouns. We're going to look at all four of these categories one at a time. And we're going to do that by exploring it through this chart of English pronouns. We're going to call these personal pronouns. And we're first going to look at subject pronouns. So you can read this by on the top are a couple of the categories of pronouns we're going to look at. And on the left side, it's telling us the perspective. Is it first person? Is it second person? If it's third person, is it male or female? Are we talking about a person or are we talking about a thing? And also, are we talking about one person, two people, or three people? Okay, so that's how you're reading the left-hand column. Let's start by looking at subject pronouns. Subject pronouns are just that. They're the subject of the sentence. They're who or what the sentence is about. There's a reason I'm having us look at nouns and pronouns first, because your next lecture is on subject and verbs and objects, okay? So in order to understand that, you need to understand nouns and pronouns. So there's a reason why I'm doing this first. But subject pronouns, they're at the beginning of the sentence. I went to the store. She bought a ham. He does not like ham. What I want, our tip or trick, our heuristic for this is notice how the subject pronoun is at the beginning of the sentence. Okay, so am I dealing with a subject pronoun? Well, let me start by thinking, where is it in the sentence? It's the very first part of the sentence. It's before the verb. So this might be a subject pronoun. Object pronouns, they receive the action of the sentence. Tell him, the clown scared us. Ashley called you. Notice how the object pronoun is at the end of the sentence. Our subject pronoun was at the beginning and our object pronouns are at the end. I want to look at these possessive pronouns now, and I've put a block around possessive adjectives and possessive pronouns for a reason, because one set is a pronoun and the other is an adjective, hence the name of the categories. And I want to tell you how you can distinguish with, am I dealing with adjectives or am I dealing with pronouns? Possessive pronouns, they show possession, right? Mine, yours, his, hers, ours, yours, theirs, okay? Example sentences, the house is hers. So she, her, possesses the house. I got mine. The car is ours. Notice how the possessive pronoun is at the end of the sentence. This is a lot like the object pronoun at the end of the sentence. So our heuristics don't necessarily tell you exactly what pronoun you're dealing with, but it helps you narrow down, okay, I'm obviously not dealing with a subject pronoun here. So here's how possessive pronouns are different than possessive adjectives. These are not pronouns. These are adjectives. My, your, his, her, it's, our, your, their. Okay, now I recognize that some of those are also under possessive pronouns. Look at his, right? His can be a possessive adjective or it can be a possessive pronoun. And the way to know which one it is by looking at its function in the sentence. Where is it in the sentence? Now, we haven't gone over adjectives a ton, but I did tell you that an adjective describes something about a noun. That was something we learned a couple lectures ago. So let's look at the sentence, it was his house. So remember how I told you how his can be a possessive pronoun or a possessive adjective. Well, a possessive pronoun is at the end of the sentence. When I look at it was his house, his is not the end of the sentence. His does not occur at the end of the sentence. It occurs before the noun house. Well, I gave you the definition of an adjective as something that describes something about the noun. Well, if I want to describe something about house, I can describe it as his. So this is how I know in this instance, his is functioning as an adjective, not a pronoun. We can also look at my car is for sale. My car is for sale. Okay, well, the possessive pronoun occurs at the end of the sentence. My is occurring at the beginning of the sentence. On the previous slide, we just looked at, or on two slides ago, we looked at subject pronouns, which also occur at the beginning of the sentence. So how do I know my is not a subject pronoun, but is instead a possessive adjective? Well, that has to do with the fact that adjectives describe nouns, right? So my car, describe the car to me. Well, it's mine, right? It's my car. So I know my is in this instance performing as an adjective because it's describing the noun car, and it's not a subject pronoun, okay? Because if it was a subject pronoun, there wouldn't be another noun there. Pronouns replace nouns. You would never have a pronoun and a noun right next to each other in a sentence unless that pronoun is actually an adjective describing something about the noun. Possessive adjectives, just real quick to tie it to teaching. How might possessive adjectives be difficult for Spanish speakers? Well, in Spanish, when they're saying something is his or hers, they have the pronoun su, so su libro. And su can mean his or her. It's not gender specific. So when a Spanish speaker is learning English, this might be the type of pronoun they would struggle with because in Spanish, in their first language, there is not a gender specific pronoun to mean his or her. It's just su. It's one pronoun. Let's move into reflexive pronouns. So we're going to wrap up our personal pronouns now. Reflexive pronouns refer back to the word to which it refers. Okay, so I told you that pronouns can replace nouns or it can replace or speak to other pronouns. So these reflexive pronouns refer back to either a noun or a pronoun that was already introduced to us in the sentence. So I have a list for you of what reflexive pronouns look like, myself, yourself, himself, herself, etc. And let's look at it in context. I will go by myself. So myself is the reflexive pronoun. And I told you that it refers back to a word that's already been introduced to us in the sentence. So myself is referring back to the pronoun, the subject pronoun, I. The next sentence, they had dinner by themselves. Themselves is referring back to the subject pronoun they. Mary behaved herself this time. Herself is referring back to the noun Mary. So notice how reflective pronoun is after the first pronoun or noun. It always occurs later in the sentence, right? And it occurs after the verb. So we've looked at personal pronouns. Again, these are the most common nouns. They communicate person, gender, and number, so meaning how many people. I refers to one person, them refers to multiple people, so that's why we mean by number. Let's see here. So we looked at subject pronouns. They occur at the beginning of the sentence. An object pronoun occurs at the end of the sentence. Possessive pronouns, they also occur at the end of the sentence. And reflexive pronouns occur after the first pronoun or noun and after the verb. We still have four more categories of pronouns I want to look at. So again, you're not going to necessarily have all these memorized, but you have this PowerPoint to come back to kind of test your memory. Let's look at interrogative pronouns. These basically are connected to a question. It's a really easy class of pronouns to learn. What, which, who, whom, whose? Literally, we can use these to form questions. What do you want for dinner? Which color do you prefer? Who is that? Whom do you speak to? Whom is a very rare occurrence at this time, right? We don't use whom a lot. Some of you saw that in your online work for grammar, online work number one. And whose sweater is this? We can also use these interrogative pronouns to form statements that are not necessarily in the question form, but you can read these statements and still go, oh, it's still kind of a questiony statement. I wonder what we're doing tomorrow. I wonder what we're doing tomorrow. Okay, she asked which train to take. I'm wondering who will be at the party. You should ask whom to call. I wonder whose dog knocked our garbage can over. Okay, so we can still use interrogative pronouns within a statement. It doesn't have to be the question form, but it's still leaving that questiony feeling. Relative pronouns connect a clause or a phrase to a noun or a pronoun. We haven't covered clauses and phrases yet. We'll do that later, but I think this concept is pretty easy to understand. And I have two example sentences here to illustrate it. So here's a list of our relative pronouns. And again, some of them look like other pronouns we've already seen. For example, who and whom, those were also examples of interrogative pronouns. But we can use who and whom as relative pronouns in the right context. No one word is stuck to one category. It's about its function in the sentence. Is who functioning in this sentence as a question or as an interrogative, or is who functioning in this sentence as a relative pronoun? And we can look closer at the sentence to figure that out. The woman who called yesterday wants to buy the house. So relative pronouns connect a clause or phrase. So in this case, our phrase is who called yesterday to a noun or a pronoun. So who is actually referring to woman, the noun woman. The woman who called yesterday wants to buy the house. And depending on how you say this sentence, you can hear the clause inside of it. The woman who called yesterday wants to buy the house. This sentence could easily just say the woman wants to buy the house. But when we say the woman who called yesterday, who is the woman? Wants to buy the house, we're using a relative pronoun inside our clause. In our second sentence, we could say the girl has sent us a card. But I can add a little clause inside of it. The girl that we met in France has sent us a card. That is a relative pronoun referring back to the noun or pronoun, in this case, referring back to the pronoun, the noun girl. We could also say the girl who we met in France has sent us a card. And again, this is just a lexical choice. We tend to use who or that interchangeably in English. Indefinite pronouns, they don't refer to anything specific, meaning they don't refer to a specific quantity Or a specific amount of something. So anything, anybody, anyone, everybody, everyone. And you can see how this would work. These would work in sentences. Do you have anything? Anybody home? I love someone. All is lost. And these are all examples of pronouns, but we call these indefinite pronouns. And this is going to be the last set of pronouns we look at. And again, much like possessive pronouns, we had possessive adjectives. So with demonstrative pronouns, we also have demonstrative adjectives, and we need to be careful to distinguish inside the sentence we're looking at whether or not the demonstrative word is a pronoun or an adjective. Okay, because sometimes it might look like a pronoun when it's really an adjective, and that's a whole different part of speech. So a demonstrative pronoun, they point to specific things. That, this, here, there, those, these. This is an apple. Let's go over here. Something we can notice about demonstrative pronouns is that they can occur at the beginning or the end of the sentence, but it's not necessarily next to a noun. It's always before or after the verb. This is the verb, an apple. Let's go over is a verb, here. Here is the noun, or here's the demonstrative pronoun. Demonstrative adjectives, on the other hand, tell us whether the noun or nouns we're talking about are singular or plural, and whether they are close to us or not. So, okay. Let's look at our first example. These books are too expensive. So if we look at the noun books, we have a word before it, and that's the word these. And the word before it is an adjective because it's telling me something about the books. What books? These books. Okay? So these books are too expensive. These tells me that I'm referring to. What's the difference? I guess if we were in class, I would ask you, what's the difference between these books and those books? These books and those books. Well, these tells me is a word that we use to indicate that something is close, right? Something is in proximity. If I were to say those books, though, by those, I'm pointing to something that's not in my proximity. Maybe it's across the room. Maybe it's in a whole different room, but it's not right here in front of us. So these books are too expensive. These is used as an adjective, and it's telling me that the books are right in front of us and that there's more than one of them. If I was going to say one book, I would say this book, right? These means there's more than one. Let's look at the next example. This hotel is much more expensive than that hotel. So this hotel, I'm talking about one hotel. This is an adjective describing the word hotel. This meaning it's right here, probably right in front of us. It's the subject of what we're talking about. Is much more expensive than that hotel. So it's a different hotel that maybe it's the one across the street, or maybe it's the one on the other web page we've looked at. But again, this and that, those kind of look like they could be demonstrative pronouns, but they're not because they are right next to a noun describing something about the noun. You are now going to, I've rapidly gone through these different categories of pronouns. It was a lot of information, but there was no need to drag this lesson on much further. The information is in this PowerPoint and in this lecture. You're going to do an exercise now on pronouns. And here's how I want you to approach the exercise, because I'm pretty positive that none of you have all this memorized after watching it one time. When you go do the pronoun exercise entitled Exercise Pronouns, have this PowerPoint open, okay? Get familiar with this PowerPoint. And before answering a question, you need to look at the example sentence or sentences that I give you and think about, okay, where are the nouns in this sentence? Are there any nouns in this sentence? You've already learned about nouns, so can you identify those within these sentences I give you? There might not be one, but as you saw earlier, when we're looking at demonstrative adjectives or possessive adjectives, they describe nouns. So some of the tips I can give you for figuring out if you're working with a pronoun or not is to figure out, well, do I have nouns in here? So start digesting your sentence. First for nouns, do I have any nouns in my sentence? And secondly, where are the verbs, or where is the verb in your sentence? Because remember, some of those pronouns specifically occur before the verb or after the verb. So those are my tips for working through the exercise. Let me show you two practice questions. If we were in class, I would have asked you a trick question. How many pronouns are in this sentence? She went to his house. Instinctively, without a doubt, most everyone in the class is going to say two, she and his. But it's not the case because she is the only pronoun in the sentence. His in this sentence is functioning as a possessive adjective. His house. Now, if you would have followed my tricks that are my tips on the previous slide, I would have said, okay, well, identify your nouns, right? And you would have said, well, house is a noun. His house. His is an adjective describing house. You would have worked through it that way. So again, that's why I'm stressing you need to look at where your nouns are and where your verbs are. And then if I were to ask you what type of pronoun is she, you would want to go back through the slides and go, okay, what type of pronouns can occur before the verb? So again, I told you, look for the verbs in your sentence. Went. Went is the verb, right? We can look at went to as a phrasal verb. It doesn't matter, but you know went is a verb. She, okay, she occurs before the verb. What type of pronoun was that? And that was a subject pronoun. Let's look at one more, and then I'll wrap up our lecture. How many pronouns are in this sentence? She went to the house that was his. She went to the house that was his. Okay, well, I know went is our verb. House is a noun. That I've seen that earlier in the slides, so I know that it can be a pronoun. Is it in the sentence? Was his. Okay, so the answer is there are three. She is the subject pronoun we saw in the previous slide. Went to the house. That is a relative pronoun referring back to house. And was his. His is a possessive pronoun in this sentence. So again, in order to answer questions like this, you should have the slides open. Contact me if you have any questions. I know this lecture was a lot of information, but it's recorded, so you can watch it as many times as necessary. When you're done, go ahead and proceed to the next lecture or the next unit. Bye.